It was a stately house where many lives had accumulated and left their essences. It had the perfume of heavily impregnated furniture, and the very folds of the curtains contained secrets and sighs. It was also a house that seemed about to vanish. The tip of the labyrinthian stairway leading to the gate lost itself among the potted plants, the turrets dissolved into the overhanging branches of old trees. The glass doors and windows opened without sound. The floors were so highly polished, they looked transparent. The ceilings were powdered white, the damask curtains were stiff like mummy costumes. The butlers knew about the fragility. They walked almost invisibly, seemingly not touching anything. What they carried back and forth was borne on silver trays with a minuet lightness of step and was to be received with equal delicacy. Wood, silk, and paint had the brittleness of preserved flowers. The curves of the legs of the chairs were full of debonair assertion, like those of the ancient men of the family in their white stockings. The lace covers on the backs of the chairs were starched to look like paper, and the paper flowers were painted to look like lace. The mirrors were framed with white roses made of seashells. From the ceiling hung enormous glass chandeliers, blue icicle bushes shedding teardrops of blue glass light on the gold furniture. On the mantelpieces, the shepherdesses, the angels, the gods and goddesses of porcelain all seemed to have been caught while in motion by a secret enchantment and put to sleep with a dust of white sleep like those secret enchantments of nature, enclosing the drops of water in dark caves and turning them into stalactite torches, candlesticks, hooded figures. That delicacy of design only created in a void, in great silence and great immobility. No violence here, no tears, no great suffering, no shouting, no destruction, no anarchy. The secret silences, the muted pains brought about by great riches, a conspiracy of tranquility to preserve this flower-like fragility in crystal, wood, and damask. The violins were muted, the hands were gloved, carpets were unrolled forever under the feet, and the gardens cut in the sound from the world. The light from the icicle bushes threw a patina over all objects and turned them into bouquets of still flowers kept under a glass bell. The glass bell covered the flowers, the chairs, the whole room, the panoplied beds, the statues, the butlers, all the people living in the house. The glass bell covered the entire house. Every day the silence, the peace, the softness carved with greater delicacy the glass chandeliers, the furniture, the statuettes and laces, then covered them with glass. Under the giant glass bell, the colors looked inaccessible, the shapes strangely beautiful, as of something that can never be repeated. Everything had the transparency, the fragility of stalactite created in silence and obscurity, and breaking when the caves are open and the breath of man enters. Jeanne was sitting with her two brothers in the room they used as children. They were sitting in front of an armored fireplace, in three children's chairs. Her face seemed stemless and drooped listlessly as she monologued endlessly. Jean, Paul and I, nothing exists beyond our aliens. My own children do not mean as much to me as my brothers. I am devoted to my children only because I have given my word. I owe them that. But what I do for my brothers is a great joy. We cannot live without each other. If I get sick, they get sick. If they are sick, I get sick. All joys and anxieties are tripled. Their opinion of me and mine of them is our only standard. It forces us into a kind of heroic living. If I should ever say to Jean, "You've done a petty thing," he would kill himself. We three belong to the Middle Ages. We have this need of heroism, and there's no place for such feelings in modern life. That is our tragedy. Once I wanted to be a saint. It seemed the only absolute act left to do, For what is most powerful in me is a craving for purity, greatness. I am not living on earth, neither are my brothers. We are dead. We reached such heights in love that it made us want to die altogether with the loved one. And so we died. We are living in another world. Our having bodies is a farce, an anachronism. We were never even born. We have no ordinary sensual life, no contact with reality. My marriage was a farce, my brother's marriage is meaningless. When my children were born, I didn't suffer. The births were difficult, I refused to take gas. I was amused, I wanted to see myself bringing children into the world. I worked hard, I felt pain, of course, but I didn't suffer like a human being. I felt pain detachedly, as if it were not happening to my body. I have no body. I have an external envelope which deludes others into thinking I am alive. My brothers and I hate to see each other. What we like is to have long conversations together from room to room, doors open, but not seeing each other. It enrages us to meet and kiss each other in that stupid, ordinary human way, to keep up from the farce of human movements, gestures, etc., when we are dead. And complete death would be so enjoyable, because everything we do together is an enjoyment. I can't bear to see them as bodies, to see them growing old. Once I sat writing letters, and the two of them were playing cards. I looked at them and thought, what a crime it was, our being alive. It was a simulacrum. Everything was really finished long ago. We have lived already. We are far away from husbands, wives, and children. I have tried so hard to love others, and I can up to a certain point, and then no further. Beyond that, I begin to hate. Not one of us has any human sympathy. Jean does not understand why his wife weeps sometimes. We laugh at her. She's small and human. She weeps and we despise her for it. We never weep. The only thing I feel sometimes is fear, a terrific fear which catches me unaware sometimes like a fit of madness. Sometimes I become deaf in the street. I see automobiles passing and I hear nothing. At other times I seem to go blind. Everything becomes nebulous around me. But that only happens when I'm alone. When I am alone, I think I go a little mad. Sometimes I say to my husband, do you know, I believe I am supremely intelligent. He says, how vain you are. But it isn't vanity. It's an intelligence you get when you are dead. Sometimes while he's reading his newspaper, I say, wouldn't you like to be an archangel as I am? He answers me, you're a child. My brothers never say such things. We can describe to each other how it feels to be an archangel. Then when we are finished with that mood, my brothers say, let's pass to a new form of exercise. I am a descendant of Joan of Arc, only I have no role to play. I have nothing to save. We still sleep in the beds we used as children. My mother was a true queen of France. She was loved by all the great men of her time. She ruled them. She never took care of us like a mother. She was always in the center of a great passion. When the passions were over and she lost her beauty, she took drugs. She lay all day in her canopied bed, her eyes burning, murmuring broken phrases. She shut her windows and lived by the light of night candles. Her eyes were dilated and saw nothing but her dreams. She ordered a dinner for 25 persons and then forgot about it and took a stronger dose of drugs. When I came home, the chef and the housekeeper were running through the corridors shouting, Madame is raving about Napoleon. What are we going to do with the 2 dozen lobsters, the kilos and kilos of fruit? What shall we do? Madame is saying, Bonjour, Napoleon. I must make a speech, and I don't know what to say. I made the wrong start in life. A Georgian prince fell in love with Jeanne, and she tried to love him. She complained that he uttered such ordinary words, that he could never say the magic phrase which would open her being. It was Christmas morning, and she went out with the Christmas tinsel rolled around her neck, carrying one of the glass birds perched on her little finger. She took a taxi to visit the prince. When the taxi driver saw her, he would not accept payment for the journey. He was a Russian. He may have remembered the Persian prince of a woman carrying a bird on her finger. He would not let Jeanne pay. He may have divined she was going to see the prince. Jeanne put the tinsel around the taxi driver's neck, sat the birds on the taximeter, smiled and said, "Drive me home, please." That night, I mailed Jeanne the first Persian print representing the Queen of Bijapur riding on a white steed harnessed with black velvet. It was handed to her on a silver tray with her breakfast. She thought it came from the prince, and again she took a taxi, and this time she rang his bell and paid him a visit. The next day she received a picture of Baz Bakadur and Rukmati riding together by the moonlight. She thought the prince could not articulate his dreams, but that he could dream. She paid him another visit. I sent her a prince of Radha waiting for her lover Krishna. That evening they had supper together, and in accordance with the custom of his country, after they had eaten together, they threw all the dishes out of the window. The fourth day I sent her a lover's message in a Persian garden filled with feather flowers. The fifth day I sent her the prince and princess riding through a mountainous region, a servant bearing a torch. Before I exhausted my collection of Persian prints, Jeanne had discovered that Prince Mareb could not dream at all, and again her face fell listlessly like a stemless plant. In the garden one afternoon, Paul fell asleep, and as the sun was setting, it projected the outline of his face on the back of the chair. Jeanne came up and kissed the shadow. Among shadows, she was at ease. The enormous house stood behind them, with a thousand eyes looking down at them. Jeanne walked into the house and entered the room of mirrors. Ceilings of mirrors, floors of mirrors, windows of quicksilver opening on windows of quicksilver. The air was made of gelatine. Around her hair there was a saffron aureole, and her skin was a seashell, an eggshell. There was a lunar wax rim on the rim of her shoulder. Woman in prison in the stillness of mirrors, washed only by jellied colors. On her breast grew flowers of dust, and no wind came from the earth to disturb them. Flowers of dust hung serenely. Around her waist a crinoline without its cover of lace and satin, a round crinoline like a bird cage. On her throat a brooch without stones, with its little silver hooks clutching emptiness. The fan in her hand was laceless and featherless, open and bare like winter branches. She breathed on the mirror, the dew of her breath on the mirror vanished. The mirror held nothing. She closed her eyes so many times, a tunnel of eyes closing. Countless sulphurous profiles touching each other, accompanied by a rim of light. Countless women smiling, four women walking towards, four women walking towards, four women vanishing. She looked into the mirror until the dew of anxiety clouded her face. She wanted to be where she could not see herself. She wanted to be where everything did not happen twice. She walked, following the deep caverns of diminishing light. She touched ice and was bruised. To watch, she must pause, and so what she caught was never the truth. The woman panting, dancing, weeping. It was only the woman who paused. The mirror was always one breath too late to catch the breathing. Quickly, more quickly, she turned to catch the face of her soul, but even when she moved at dream speed, she saw the face of the actress, the small curtain closing inside of the pupil. She wanted to smash the mirror and be one. There was a joy of unveiling from which no human joy could call one back. There was a joy without feet or voice or warmth, but the mirror revealed only the prying. If she could not catch the ultimate flame of life, could she detect death? She bowed nearer to catch the immobility, the death, but the caverns within the pupils of the eye diminish and close at the sight of death. The eye dead could not see the eye dead in the mirror. At death all mirrors are covered to bury reflection. Death never permitted an echo. Death cannot be made visible or cast a shadow of its presence. She watched her sorrow. She looked at the tears. The sorrow unveiled and reflected before her ceased to be her own. It was the sorrow of another with a space between them. She looked at the tears and they froze and died. She ran out into the somnambulistic garden. Her brother was still asleep like one enchanted. The glass bell which separated them from the world was visible in the light. Would Jeanne see it? Would she smash it and be free? She did not see it. She kissed the shadow of her brother. He awakened. She said, "Let me touch something warm. Save me from reflections. The mirror frightened me." But her hand was lying on the shadow of her brother and not on him. Then she said, "I am afraid that of the three of us I will be the first one to die. I am the lightest. I saw in the mirror not my death, but the image of myself in the tomb. I was wearing a brooch without stones, a crinoline with all its silk covering eaten away." Her guitar was lying at her feet. As she said this, the string broke.